I'm Philip Alfred Don Davis, but I'm known as Peter. And I left school when I was 15, at the beginning of the Second World War, and went to work on my father's farm, which then was 178 acres. But the Wark Agate said, well, would he take over the Bartestree 140 acres there at 5 shillings an acre? So we did that. And I always remember when I was had been home about 3 years, I thought, well, I shall never manage that. But anyway, I had to do it sooner than I thought, because father was playing tennis and he fell over and he had a compound fracture of his leg. And he was in hospital a long time, and it was just harvest time and getting ready for hop picking. And so I had to sort that all out and get the hop pickers fixed up. And then I used to go up in a kiln and get little pots of hops, because he was home then and had his bed in the lounge, and get these little pots of hops to show him to see if they were ready to dry.
So hop picking season was huge here, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, it was all hand picking then. I mean, we didn't have a picking machine till 1955. We picked 600 pockets by hand, but that was the best time of hops, because the hop picking was, the atmosphere was fantastic, because we had 2 busloads of Welsh people living in the buildings, and then we had several busloads from Hereford, and then you'd got the local people and the travellers, and they all got on well together, and the singing was wonderful, and was working in the hop yards, then I think I was hauling the sacks, and I did my first business transaction. One of the ice cream people came and said to me, will you stop anybody else coming to sell ice cream? I said, yes, I'll do that if I can have ice cream every day. And I did, and that's what I did. I had an ice cream every day for the hop picking.
Very clever businessman.
Yeah.
How many hop pickers used to come here?
Well, we had about 50 or 60 living in the buildings. And then we had, I think, up to 5 busloads, 60-seater busloads come from Hereford every day. And then we had, 20 locals. And I can't remember how many travellers there were, but it was, there were 5 or 6 caravans with their horses.
The travellers?
They'd stay in one of the fields just by the farm.
And the people from South Wales, what was their accommodation?
Oh, they lived in the buildings. I mean, when first of all, it was pretty primitive. They were living in the cattle sheds. But then we converted the, there was a new building built by Lady Emily Foley, which was going to be the new hop kilns. And we converted that into a barracks for them. That was fantastic. And then as we increased, we built underneath for them as well.
Did you ever have people from the Black Country here?
No, the Dormington had them from the Black Country, but we had them from South Wales. They used to come by train, special train, and you send a cart to get the luggage. And you wouldn't know how many you'd got, because they'd go to the Foley Arms and stagger back later on in the daytime. I remember one person who came was Mrs. Reardon, the mother of Ray Reardon, the snooker player. He was at Claston when he was a boy.
Do you remember him?
Yes. And then I can remember there was another woman, Mrs. Vaughan, who'd had 19 children, 3 husbands. And she'd reared 18 of them.
She used to come here?
Yes, yes. Several of the families had biggest number of children, but they were always good hop pickers, and we never had much trouble. Father always talked to Mr. Bray, who lived next door. that was a big hop farmer, and they fixed the price they wanted to pay per bushel. And so they said that, well, we'll put it up a bit more, so that they're bound to go on strike. And he said, well, if we don't put it up, they'll still go on strike. So they put it up, and of course they went on strike, and then they dropped it to what they were going to pay. There was no problem.
So when you would get the same families returning one generation after the
yes.
other?
Yes, oh yes, yeah.
Could you tell us a bit about that?
Well, I mean, I can't remember too much about it. I remember it's a long time ago. But, I mean, they came, well, we always had granny and grandfather. We didn't have men in, we didn't allow men to come when we had so many, or only a few. And I remember the granny and then the daughter with their children and then the children. But it's just a long time ago. I can't remember too much about it. But we've got all the count books from 1919 right through to when we stopped hop picking. Yeah.
Peter?
Yeah?
Can we just talk a bit about the account book? You were describing it to
yeah.
me. Can you just talk about
yeah.
it again?
Well, there were two account books, actually. This is the one that was in the hop yard. Because you knew they were all piecework and picked by the bushel. So each time there was a busheling, it was written in the book, and the pickers had a card. And then at the end of hop picking, it was all totaled up how much they'd earned, and it would be down in there how much they'd drawn to live on and then they'd be paid the difference. But it's interesting, we've got all the names of these people, so that's what's so interesting. Well, every picker had a tally card, and then there was the card. You had the lady who went round with the bushler to write it down, and that's the books I've got from 1919 till I think it was 1943 or 44. But it's interesting in there because you've got all the names of the pickers, and how much they earned, and you've got them all. Not only just the Welsh people, but their local people and the Hereford people and the travellers, and they're fascinating. It's a fascinating book, but if you want to borrow it, one you can. I'll tell you where to get it.
Thank you. Tell me about the shop on the farm.
Well,
I imagine when people their tally was knocked off their bill from the shop. Tell
yes.
me about the shop.
No, they used to draw money, and Mother had the shop in the house. There was a little part of the house was big enough to have a shop. She sold most things. She didn't sell meat, but the butcher used to come once a week. But she sold everything else, you know, milk, butter, cheese, all the groceries that they wanted. And I remember once there was a tap on the window, and I went. Mother said, you go and see what they want. And she said, I want 3 halfpence of stamps. And I didn't know what it meant. Went back and asked Mother. Oh, she said, they meant snuff. But she did a tremendous trade. She used to buy the stuff wholesale. And a tremendous trade with sweets.
Didn't you used to like working in the shop?
Well, I didn't do much in the shop because I would always be working, and in the evening I'd be busy helping in the kilns.
What were you doing then? Tell us about that.
Well, when I left school, I hauled the sacks home, and then when we had too many cribs for one bushler, I took over as the second one. And I always remember the bushler said, now, if a person grumbles at you saying you're putting, because it was a 10-gallon basket and you had to put 8 gallons in. And she said, if they do, you tip the sop out of the sack back into the crib. And he said, that will flatten them. And when she give her the basket and she won't get them as many as you did. And I never had any trouble again.
Tell me about the policeman.
Beg pardon?
The policeman. Was there a policeman during hog picking season?
Oh, yes, there was a... Well, it was our local policeman, really. He was a super chap. He was ex-heavyweight champion of the Navy. Gunboat Smith. Oh, he was a lovely fellow. And he used to stand outside the door at the trumpet with his truncheon. And any nonsense, bong. And then they never had any trouble. I always remember I was coming back home with a tractor. And for some reason, I hadn't got a number plate. There was one being made. And he didn't say anything. He just rubbed where it was. Never said a word. And then the next time he saw me, I'd got it on. He said, I'm glad you took notice.
Did the Black Country pickers and the Welsh fight?
Well, not so much, because our pickers used to go to the Foley and they used to go to the yew tree. But the children used to have fights because they used to come into the orchard to pinch apples. And our Welsh people would fight the children from the Black Country because they said, no, these are our chokers, not yours. Because they called these little pears we had chokers. There was a church, Red Cross van in the field in front of Dormington Church, and also a church army one. And she used to come to each farm to any problems. And then the church army one, they used to lead the singing in the hop yards. And on a Sunday, I think it was, they used to have a service in the hop yard, and the singing was fantastic. And we resurrected that. We did it for about 4 or 5 years. I know there weren't many people picking, but there were a few picking. And then we had our own local vicar, and then we had a guest vicar. The Bishop of Ludlow was one who came, and the agricultural chaplain. So I always remember when John Selby came, the Bishop of Ludlow, he brought 2 bottles of beer. And he said, one's for your vicar and one's for you. But he said, because when I went out to get invited out to dinner, I used to take two bottles of this, bishop's finger, and then you could say 2 fingers to the bishop. Very briefly, we had a confirmation in Dormington Church. There were 5, and he came, and we'd found it was his birthday. So we made a birthday cake for him. And I also thought, well, I can't give him a bishop finger, but I'll give him 2 bottles of speckled hen. So when he came out after changing to talk to people, they gave him the birthday cake, and I gave him these 2 bottles of old speckled hen. And he cut the cake there and then and shared it. I went into the kilns to have a look, and the dryer said to Father, who's drying these hops? Is it Peter or is it me? And Father said to me, don't you go in there again. But the next year I was doing the hop drying.
Can you just describe Peter? When the families, the children would arrive from South Wales, funny haircuts and very pale. Can you describe that and what it was like at the end of the hop picking season?
Well, they all had what they called their hop picking haircut. It was all shaved off except a little fringe, and they were as white as ghosts. And when they all went back, they were as brown as a berry, and the hair had grown quite a bit. It was surprising how much they grew, because hop picking lasted about 3 or 4 weeks. and oh, it did them power of good.
Was it, what were the old miners like?
Beg pardon?
What, you said you used to listen to the old miners.
Yeah.
Telling stories.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Well, I can't remember. They were all telling about life in the mines and what they did and the pit ponies and all that sort of thing. Have you not been down a mine?
I have.
Yeah, you went back down Big Pit.
Yes. I didn't like it.
No, I didn't like it, but it was an experience you should never forget.
It must have been fascinating for a country boy hearing those stories.
Yes. I can't remember much about it. But going on from then, in 1948, Father took on some more hops, and I was made a partner. And so I began to take more management. And I was always interested in research. And I did some work for East Malling and Rosemond to kill it. We had a very bad disease called nettlehead, because hops are related to nettles. And anyway, we tried all sorts of different chemicals, and I did the trials, and we found one that worked. And it, when we replanted, nettlehead has never been seen since. But what I'd found was it was a chemical you had to use. So you took the hops out the year before and rested the land. And then we ploughed the land about 6 inches deep and put a thing on there that this chemical could trickle into the furrow. And that worked, because the nettlehead was spread by two things. One was an eelworm and the other was the hop damson aphid.
I wonder if you could describe what happened in when people were picking hops. Did you have whole families having their own crib?
Yes.
I wonder if you can just describe
that for us. Some had whole cribs, but most of them had half a crib. And then we used the bushel three times a day. And you had to be very sensible when you were busheling, because the hops would vary a lot from big hops to little hops, so that you didn't put quite so much in where there were little hops. But you can't describe hop picking then. But going back to doing that nettlehead thing, because of that, I was invited to join the Hereford and Worcester. I'm not sure what it was called, but it was hop growers and researchers, and from Herefordshire and Worcester, we used to meet and talk and work out the program from Rosemond, and. There'd only been about two meetings, and they said I must join the NFU Hops Committee. So I did that, and used to go to Widemarsh Street to the meetings. And there'd only been to two or three, and I was elected then to go to London to represent the hop growers. So I was a member of the NFU Hops Committee in London. And I hadn't been there long. When I was elected vice chairman, and I was vice chairman. The chairman had been the chairman for 40 odd years. Anyway, there was a public inquiry into the legality of the Hops Marketing Board, and I was the only hop grower from Herefordshire that went. And I had 4 hours in the witness box, and QC questioned me. Anyway, he beat me in the end, but he came across after and congratulated me on my performance. But the chairman of the Hops Committee had made such a nonsense of it that he resigned and I became chairman. And that led on to being a member of the Hop Industry Committee, which is a committee with all sides of the industry, brewers, big brewers, little brewers, scientists, everybody. And after serving on there for a fair time, I was elected chairman. And so I took that on, but we changed venue then, reduced the size of the committee. And I was chairman of the Hop Industry Committee for a number of years. father had been asked to join to farm the Dormington hop, the Allied Breweries hop farmers. And when he died, they said, would I take it over? So then when I was doing all this work in London, I was farming 1,300 acres. There was Claston that Philip was farming. Dormington was 125 acres. Pomona was 133 acres. And the new farm we bought at Brierley was 250 acres. But, you know, I wasn't a farmer, really. I was a businessman because we had all the managers. But it was very interesting. Oh, probably, well, when we finished, when we got letter, it'd be probably a couple of hundred, maybe more. But of course, I wasn't involved with it so much then.
So when the gypsies, the travellers arrived, did they mix with the other people?
Not a lot. The travellers saved themselves. The only time they mixed was when they were in the hop yard picking.
When they were in the hop yard, what sort of time would they start in the
evening? Pardon?
What time did they start in the morning?
They could start any time after 7 o'clock, and they finished about 5. But you didn't worry about that as long as we hadn't got too many hops picked. But of course, if the hops were big and the conditions were right, we had to stop them earlier probably. Well, I know once or twice we couldn't bushel all the hops. We had to leave them till the next day. But it all worked very well.
And what did the children do?
Well, they all used to help picking umbrellas and little boxes. And then they used to go and play.
Where did they cook and eat and wash?
Well, we had a cookhouse. Where they had fires, and we had some iron griddles where they could cook as well. And eventually we built a proper toilet with showers and that, but that was at the end.
So when you say they arrived by train, were there special trains?
Yes, yeah, special hop picking trains.
Where to?
Well, from South Wales to Stokeyda station, and from the Midlands to, well, they stopped at Ashburton and Stokeyda.
Can we just do that bit again, Peter?
Yeah.
So where did they arrive from train?
They arrived by train at Stokeyda station on special hop picking trains, steam driven. This is going back, you're talking about the 40s, 30s. And then we used to send a wagon to collect the luggage, and then they used to walk back to Claston. But they used to call it the Foley Arms, so you never knew how many we were going to get till the next morning. When I was chairman of the Hop Industry Committee, was to organise a prize giving, which was held at Urdiston. And I had to find a guest speaker. And Wigan used to do, it was a fantastic do. And I was lucky I got Winston Churchill's son. I forget now which one, the one that was a politician. He was one I got, and ex-Bank of England chairman was another. And Lady Cottrell was another one. There were four I had, I can't remember what the other one was. But they were all so interesting to talk to.
Do you, in the evenings, did the hop pickers have parties and dancing?
Not really, no. By the time they'd finished picking and cooked their evening meal, they were ready for bed.
Was there any romance?
Well, I don't know, it must have been. There must have been. But I don't know. I mean, I wasn't out mixing with them, because I was in the kilns working till the hop picking machines came.
So what were you doing in the kilns, Peter?
Well, I was a hop dryer, loading and unloading the kilns. And because in the end we had 7 kilns, so we were drying 1,100 sacks a day.
So is that sort of job wasn't that, you didn't give the hop pickers those sorts of jobs?
No, no.
That was left to you and your regular farm workers?
Yes, that's right. Well, some of them used to help to do the pressing. Some of them were helping to load and unload the kiln. Some of the Welsh came to do that. But they were very good at that.
What about outside of hops picking season? What about the stringing and the wiring?
Well, our own people used to do the stringing. Before chemicals came, we used to earth the hops up in the late spring, and then in the autumn you ploughed the middle of the road, and then in the spring you ploughed that furrow away, and then you had to cut the roots off at ground level, and those pieces would grow.
Do you like beer, Peter?
Yes. I'm not a great beer drinker, but I'm very fond of beer. A nice glass, well, there's some fabulous beers now, absolutely fabulous. Well, I built a new set of kilns, completely automated. So when the hops came out of the hop picking machine, they went on to conveyors to the kilns, and we could pick 2 varieties, and they were dried by gas, and there was a little motor to unload 4 kilns. You set it to whichever one you were unloading, and then there was a big central conveyor, and then we had a baler which baled, every bale was the same weight, and when you connected it all up on the electrical box, when you wanted to press, you started the baler, and that would start it, the sequence to get the hops to the baler, and you had 7 presses in a bale, so that when there were so many kilos in, it should stop and press, stop everything and press, and automatically then it would pick it up and do it again till it was full.
Very, very different.
Yeah. Well, we used to have 14 men in the kilns, and with the press, you wanted 4.
Was there somebody whose responsibility it was to keep the fire going? The anthracite fire? Did you have somebody?
Yes, one of the men in the kilns used to do that. I was church warden for 50 years, but it was very simple then. You didn't have much to do, not like they do now. And then I was a member of the parish council. I had 20 years on the parish council, and I was chairman twice. And then I was chairman of the Association of South Herefordshire Parish and Town Councils.
Involvement with Hereford Football Club.
Yeah. Well, I went to see, my father took me to the first time in 1933 to see a friendly against Tottenham Hotspur, the schools all at half day. And then when I had to, we had time, father and I used to go in the old stand sitting on a wooden bench, and we used to supply bales for them when there were matches to make so they could have more people to sit. And then when the new stand was built, I took a team of men and we put all the seats in. And then we did the Len Weston stand as well. We fixed all the seats. And then I was a vice president. And I used to be a lot of work to do. You'd be so many of you on duty. And you had to make sure that you welcomed the presidents and chairman of the visiting football clubs and things like that. It's very interesting. You met a lot of very interesting people. The day after when we beat Newcastle, I shall never forget Ronnie Radford's score. They would sell tickets to play because they were playing West Ham on the Wednesday. So we went in, I took my secretary with me, and they were, it was about 10:30, and they were queued 6 deep all the way around the ground. And they actually sold 15,000 tickets that morning. It's amazing. But I used to do other things with the ground. We used to spread the fertilizer on it and harrow it and do various things.
Tell me about the goal, Ronnie Radford's goal. You were in the stands?
Yes, I was sitting in the stand, and it was interesting really, because McDonald was playing for England, and he'd scored a goal in the first half. Because the Hereford centre half had broken his leg, and he didn't realise that till he couldn't get as high as McDonald, so he had to go off. And then when the second half came, it was obvious that Hereford were fitter; they were more up for it. And I can always remember it. Tyler was playing, and who went on to play for West Ham for years, and he gave a lovely pass to Radford, and he just strolled on it. It was just right, and he hit it perfectly. And you could see the goalkeeper was never going to stop it. They still show it lots of times on television. And then the other one I remember was...
Can you just talk about the atmosphere in the ground?
Oh, it was electric. Absolutely electric. Because the ground was packed. And then the second goal, the winning goal, was scored by, I can't think of his name now, but he got the ball nearest the corner flag, and he managed to go all the way along the goal line till he was about 5 or 6 yards from the goal. And they didn't stop him, and he just came out about 5 or 6 yards, plonked it in the net. Well, of course, the whole place erupted.
So you were vice president during the football club's heyday?
Yes. Yes.
What was that like?
Oh, it was wonderful, because you met so many people. It was a lot of work to do, but it was interesting. But because you'd be dealing with finance and things like that. But it was the directors were the problem. They had some dreadful directors who appointed some awful managers. But we won't go into that.
It's still the same nowadays, isn't it?
Now it's different. The team they've got now, they've got a marvellous manager. Well, he was manager before of the youth team. And he was in the Youth Cup. And he actually had to go and play Manchester City in the semi-final, and he lost that 2-1 with a penalty. But Peter Beadle now is the players all want to play for him, and the manager, they're all united, all working together. That's the great thing.
Did any of your hot pickers go and see Hereford play?
I don't know. I don't expect so. No, because we'd be picking in the morning. But I don't think I went in hot picking.
Did you meet Derek Evans, the photographer?
Derek? Yes, I knew him well. And Jim Finney.
Tell me about Derek.
Well, I mean, I didn't know him that well, but I mean, he used to come taking photographs. And he came out to class a lot of time, took a lot of photographs of hops. And I saw him. I joined the Found Hope History Club. And I went there, and he was there, and we had a chat. Because you knew I'd written a book. Yeah.
Very good book.
Did you have one?
Yeah, I've read it. I think I borrowed one from Bromyard History Society. Yeah.
Did you find it interesting?
Fascinating. When you're ready.
Yeah. What was that?
I'll show you this in a minute, but if you can just say to me, I was the biggest hop grower in Europe.
Yeah. Well, I forget who told me that. I didn't realise it, but I wasn't interested anyway.
If you could just say it, though.
I was told when we had all the hops at Brierley, 600 acres, that I was the biggest hop grower in Europe. Because most of them in Germany, you see, would only be a few acres.
I mean, what was your day like? You must have been a very, very busy man.
Oh, there weren't many spare moments. Well, it depends. I mean, when I was going down to Kent, and of course I used to go to the, what do they call it? There's a conference every year, and I used to go to those. That took me to different places, Yugoslavia. When Tito was alive, oh, it was marvellous, absolutely fabulous. And then I went to Germany a couple of times. Well, I went to Germany lots of times on business. I went to Germany, and I went to Belgium, Australia, Tasmania, and America in Yakima.
So, is it okay to describe you as king of the hops?
No. No, I'm just an ordinary hop grower.
Or lord of the hops.
Hmm?
Lord of the hops.
Yes. If it hadn't been for me, the hedgerow hops would have failed. Because when we were in America, we discovered the Americans were trying to grow hedgerow hops. And Dr. Neve, who was head of Y breeding program, said, well, in my work, I've been throwing plants away with dwarfing habits. And I said, well, when you find some, I want to be the first to have some. And that was in, about the late 90s. And then about 3 years later, in April, I had a message, I've got 200 plants of three varieties for you to plant. So we dug up the wheat and propagated some more in mispropagation to have enough. So we had three rows of each in 93. We had a funny old machine to pick them. And then we had a few more in 94. And then in 95, we had a hop picking machine from Eastern Europe, and that broke down before we started. Anyway, and then in 96, we planted a lot and had our own mobile hop picking machine. It was the first in this country. And because I was the first to have one, it only cost me 76,000. The others were 80 something. And that machine is still working today absolutely perfectly. But the man who designed it, Robin Pierce, it's called the Robin, did a lot of the work on Concord, designing the models.
So did you get an award for this?
I don't think so.
Did you get an award?
But for all the work I did with the hedgerow hops, I got an MBE. That was a wonderful day. My sister and Pam, we went to London and stayed at the Farmers Club because I was a member of the Farmers Club and had lunch. And then in the evening, we went to see Chitty Bang Bang. And then the next morning, we got ready to go to the palace. And we had to be there by 10:30. And then it was given to me by the Queen. And I also remember it. They told you what you had to do, going so far and bow, go so and bow. But what I was amazed at, when I shook hands, she hadn't got gloves on. But oh, it was a wonderful, I mean, all over in a few, in literally minutes. But it was, you never forget.
A very proud moment.
Yes.
Very proud moment.
And Pam was, and my sister, well, they were told to get in there early, and they were in the fourth row so they could see everything. I've got a film all about it.
And these were all taken here, were they, Rick?
Some of them were.
Yeah.
I've seen them before.
Have you seen?
Some of them before.
Oh, I can't remember.
We'll just go through them.
Oh, I can remember Mrs. Smith. I can remember her. She was, a marvellous hop. She used to work for us regularly, hop tying and all sorts of things. But she was a marvellous hop picker.
Where was she from?
She lived in, well, they used to live in a caravan and they were living in Tarrington.
Is that her daughter?
Must be. I can't remember. But I know that was Mrs. Smith.
What makes somebody a good hop picker? Just very quick?
Yes. They got the knack.
Was it piecemeal work then, Peter?
All piecework.
Yeah. So the quicker they worked, the more money they
got.
That's
right. Yes, that's what that book is. Well, that reminds me, if you want to cop that 1919 book, if you want to borrow it.
Love to. Love to.
You'll have to get the key of the office, and it's on the shelf on the left-hand side. It's the first one.
That's very, very kind of you.
Are there any more of those?
Did you have people in the hop fields who were star pickers?
Yeah.
Did you have someone who was like every year earned more than anyone else?
Yes.
Was Mrs. Smith one of those?
Oh, yes.
Now, who's this man with the basket then?
I don't recognise him.
But what was he doing?
He's the man with the basket and he's the one holding the sack and there's the lady doing the booking.
Ah.
But I don't think that's a Claston.
Don't you?
No, I'm sure it isn't.
Mm. No. So they were...
But it's exactly the same we did at Claston.
So they were counting how... This is a bushel, is it?
Yeah, yeah.
And then, so they would get paid per bushel?
So bushels, yes.
Mm.
But he looked to have got a lot in there because it was a 10-gallon bushel and you had to put 8 gallons in it.
Did you?
Yeah.
How long would it take to fill a bushel?
Well, it depended on the pickers. I mean, some would only pick 2 or 3 in a day.
A day?
Yeah, some of them were dreadful, a waste of time.
Mm-hmm. Would they come back the next year?
Yes.
There's another little boy again.
Yeah, I don't know who that is.
No, looks like he's having a good time there, doesn't he? Looks like he... Now, what's this? This is a caravan.
Yes.
Do you think these are travellers?
Yes, those would be travellers. Mm. Yes. But, I mean, I can't see who they are.
Oh, no, of course you can't. But this is a sort of family group you would have at your farm.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And they would cook over an open fire?
Yes. But they would have their own fire.
They wouldn't share it with people from South Wales?
No.
No. It's a fantastic photograph. Was it pulled by a horse then?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
So it must have been very colourful when the travellers were arriving.
I mean, the later years, they had fabulous proper caravans and pulled by the car.
Mm.
The china they used to have was wonderful.
Was it really?
Yeah.
And the caravans are absolutely spotless too, aren't they?
Yeah. Yes, that's the same, but they were all travellers. Around the fire. I always remember Father had an Austin Princess with a Rolls Royce engine in it. And he wanted to sell it. And one of the hoppers said, well, I'll buy that from you. So they agreed a deal. And he came down to pay Father, and he said, are you sure that's enough? I got plenty more money in the bag.
And say, all these prams. Yeah. You see these prams so often in these hop-picking photos, don't you?
Yes.
And the kettle.
Yeah.
What always strikes me is they always look rather smart in their coats and their dresses and their hats, don't they?
Oh, the travellers, they weren't badly dressed.
No. And hop pickers in general always seem to be.
Now that is one of the people from. We had some from down in the southwest.
Of England?
Yes. Really? No, it isn't. I'm telling you wrong. That's a Hoskins. Father Hoskins.
Father Hoskins?
Yes.
Where's he from?
Yes, the family used to live at the Hyde, my mother's old farm. But then they came to Claston and Jack Hoskins and his brother worked for us.
Really?
Yeah.
But they were locals?
Yes.
So what do you remember about him? What do you remember about him?
Don't remember too much. You must remember this is all a long time ago.
It is a long time ago.
Yeah.
I think he looks like quite a character.
Yeah.
Doesn't he?
Oh, yes, they were.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of like his waistcoat.
Yeah.
And his hands look like he's worked hard for a living, doesn't it? Yeah. Okay, Rick?
Mm-hmm.
You don't see children with dirty faces like that much anymore, do you?
No. That's in a hot period somewhere.
And you were saying that by the time they left, they looked a picture of health with, you know, they got the sun on their faces and their hair had grown.
They looked different altogether.
Yeah. It must have been great having so many children around.
Yeah.
What's this in the background then, Peter?
I don't know what that is. Oh, it's part of a hop yard.
Ah, right. And that's another child?
Yes.
In not looking very happy there?
No, no.
Looks like their hair's grown a little bit too.
That isn't a Welsh boy. It was only the Welsh boys that had their hair cut.
Was it?
Yeah.
So they look like young teenagers, don't they?
Yeah.
Or teenagers.
Yeah.
Having a sneaky fag.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I suppose everyone smoked in those days, didn't they?
Yeah.
So you were saying that somebody came into your shop asking for...
Three apiece of stamps.
Stamps.
Yeah.
So that's snuff.
It was snuff.
So people still took snuff in those days?
Yeah.
And did you the shop sell cigarettes too and tobacco?
Oh, yes. Well, you could still buy snuff.
Yeah.